Welcome to Christ's Clarity. One simple question. Is it possible to take the conflict out of the idea of conflict? Is that possible? It's an important question because that's exactly what we're trying to do with this world, with our experiencing here. We're trying to take conflict out of the idea of conflict. We're trying to get rid of the conflict that arises from the idea of conflict. And I tell you for sure, it cannot be done. What we need to do is to choose a new idea, a non-conflictual idea. Now, what is a conflictual idea? A conflictual idea is an idea which conflicts with reality, which essentially says the reality isn't real, that it can be changed. An idea, the idea of changing reality conflicts with the way reality is. That's a conflictual idea. A non-conflictual idea would be simply to accept reality as it is and not try and change it. So, very simple. What is a conflictual idea? The idea of spirit wanting to be prime creator is a conflictual idea. Idea of conflict. In other words, this idea is in conflict with the way that reality is. A non-conflictual idea would be to say, I accept reality as it is. The idea of accepting reality as it is. So what we do is we exchange ideas. We exchange the idea of wanting to be prime creator for the idea of not wanting to be prime creator. A conflictual idea for a non-conflictual idea. This is salvation. Salvation is very simple. This is salvation, and nothing else is salvation. That's why there's only one way to be saved, and that is to exchange these ideas. You can never, ever get the conflict out of a conflictual idea. It's absolutely futile, and yet that is what everybody is trying to do. It brings about trouble. In fact, the more you try to do that, the worse it gets, the more intense conflict goes. Those who are saying, I want to bring peace to the world, we have to bring peace to the world, peace, 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 and all this talk sounds very spiritual. It actually makes things worse. There's a fact that it makes things much more intense. It makes worse conflict. Worse conflict. Because you're trying to do the impossible. Now, what happens, let's say, for instance, when two people, quote-unquote, join together and share something? Where's the conflict go? It gets projected out onto someone else outside that clique. Now, a group gets together and they say, we all agree, and we're no longer in conflict. But what do they agree upon? They actually are agreeing upon that someone else is bad out there. Someone outside the group is where the conflict is in conflict with them. They're fine. They're innocent, but someone out there is in conflict with them. That is the problem. That's why things get worse. The more we pursue this notion of bringing peace to the world, the more severe the conflict becomes. The resolution is simple. Don't expect other people to please you within the idea of conflict. Accept the conflict within the idea of conflict. Don't have expectations that this idea is supposed to be non-conflictual. In other words, don't expect to find quote-unquote true love within this idea. Don't expect other people to be pleasing to you. Don't get upset when you feel that maybe they don't like you and you don't like them. That's fine. What we need to do is accept the fact we have a quote-unquote sinful idea, a conflictual idea. Simple idea, sin means in conflict with reality, a denial of reality, an idea that denies reality. That is inherently conflictual and unpleasant for us, and we have to accept that fact and not try and get rid of the conflict. Instead, we need to focus all our attention on choosing a new idea. So when you go about your life, don't expect people to like you. Don't expect everybody to be pleasing to you. Some people you'll like more than others. That's fine. Just like, say, I don't like you and you don't like me, and that's okay. We shouldn't be expecting people to satisfy us, to make us feel non-conflictual. It's an impossible demand. So what happens is we try to bring peace, peace, peace to the world. We place impossible demands upon the world, upon each other. Impossible demands upon each other. And when we don't meet those impossible demands, of course, then we feel betrayed. And that's when hatred arises. See, just feeling conflict does not have to give rise to hatred. It's only when we expect that others are supposed to make us feel free of conflict, then the hatred and it gets intense and attack arises, that kind of thing. So basically we have to accept our basic misery here and then focus on choosing a new idea and ironing out the objections to that. That is salvation. That is what we need to be doing. If we're not doing that, we're being derelict and we're projecting on others the demand that they take away our feeling of conflict. And this leads to tremendous animosity building up. So this is how I see it. It's very, very simple. And the idea of don't project expectations on others to take away your feeling of conflict is the key. Then you won't get caught up in all of this drama, you know, the psychodrama that goes, that's going on in the world. You'll just say, hey, that's okay. I don't have to like everybody. Everybody doesn't have to like me. I can feel any way I want to feel. Others can feel the way they want to feel. And I'm not expecting them to approve of the way I feel. And I don't have to approve the way they feel. And let's just all be humble together and realize that we have this idea of conflict is going to be conflictual. So we're not going to join together. We're not going to make a peaceful world. It's impossible. But we don't have to, because we can choose a non-conflicted idea, which presents us with an experience that it has no conflict in it whatsoever. Call it a seamless overlay of bliss. And we can still use the symbols that we use for conflict. We can use those, and now they're showing us just no conflict at all. So this is a perspective that does not get enough airtime in the world. In fact, it gets almost no airtime, and it seems to run counter to the prevailing currents of the world. And indeed, it does. It's super difficult to get this viewpoint in the world, because everybody in the world thinks the answer is to reduce conflict in the world, is to get rid of conflict, which is mean make peace among everyone. Let's homogenize everyone. Let's all get together. Let's make rules and laws that outlaw any dislike of each other, any negative comments, all this kind of stuff. And when you say no, that makes things worse. In the long run, it makes things worse. And people say, what are you talking about? Are you for conflict? You want conflict in the world? You don't want peace? And so you seem like you're an antichrist or something if you speak about this. But it's just the opposite. Just the opposite. Informing people of what works is not antichrist at all. Informing people of their mistake is not antichrist at all. It's those that are saying, let's get rid of conflict in the world. That's the path of futility, called the antichrist. It's the path of futility. It doesn't work. It doesn't work. It makes things, in the long run, it makes it a lot worse. Now, short term, you can pass all sorts of laws and put people in jail, and people think, oh, we're getting rid of conflict. Those who want peace, it's amazing how zealous they are in getting rid of everybody that opposes their quote-unquote plan. They're very zealous about that. Live and let live. Mind your own business. Don't demand happiness to come from others or to come from anything in this world. It could come from anything in a conflicted idea. Happiness can never come from that. Only conflict can come from that. But we don't have to exacerbate the conflict. We don't need to make it worse. It's already bad enough. It can easily be made worse. So we say, you know, love your brother, meaning support humility in one another, meaning allow them their unhappiness. Allow them their misery. Don't say, hey, I want you to be happy so that I'm happy because I see you're happy. I want you to, you know, be the way I want you to be that makes me happy. Now, if people are kind of miserable and downcast, let them be that way, because this idea is a miserable idea. And trying to make it an appealing idea is superficial and folly, and it leads to much worse misery later on. So the world needs those who say, hey, everybody, it's okay to be miserable. In fact, just abide in your misery and then use that as a thorn in your side to consider choosing a new idea, a non-conflictual idea, and to iron out, spend your time ironing out your objections. There's lots of objections that arise, and you just iron them out, and you become, you get closer and closer and closer to choosing a new idea, which is exactly what needs to be done. A non-conflictual idea, an idea that doesn't conflict with reality. The idea of spirit being prime creator conflicts with reality. It's a conflictual idea inherently. Now, reality is not fighting against it. It's just that this idea can never be. It's in opposition to what is and will always be. It's in opposition. So this idea always feels it's being persecuted. There's a persecutory feeling, like that reality is persecuting this idea, not letting it be what it wants to be, that reality is bigoted, that reality is prejudiced, not letting us be happy with this idea. All right, so this is all important. If we must stop trying to get the conflict out of a conflicted idea. That's trying to separate cause and effect, trying to separate an idea with its effects, and it's the great disease of existence. And who can explain this in this world? It seems to just be so rarely talked about, because you feel like a bad person. You say, how can I be against peace? I mean, everybody's trying to bring peace to the world, and you're saying, no, that's wrong. That's right. It is wrong. It is the opposite. The more you try to bring peace to the idea of conflict, the more war you actually foster. The worse you get, you're actually promoting and bringing about war and conflict when you try to bring peace to this idea. Absolutely. So if you want to know where does war and attack and all this come from, it comes from the efforts to impose peace and non-conflict upon a conflictual idea. That's where it comes from. It inherently stirs things up and makes it so much worse. So this is a surprising saying, but I have to say this because the times are such right now that we are in big trouble. The beatdown is beginning. I rightly said in April, coming up to May, I said May is the month. May is the month where you will begin to feel the intensity of destabilization. And this is exactly right. It's been exactly right. I even said the 4-4-4-4, the four fours of 44th president, 4 years, 4 months, on that date, which was yesterday, was really the 20th, is very significant destabilization will take place. What happened? The monster tornado. The monster tornado, which is, because this symbolizes destabilization. It's also very interesting that the reports were all reported that 51 people died. And when I heard that, I said, you know what? There's something strange about that. There's something isn't right. And I commented about it to people. I said, it's 51 days since the resurrection of Jesus. Pentecost was Sunday, 50th day. And then the 51st day, 51 people died. And then today they say, oh, no. Only 24 died. 2-4, 24, okay. What is coming up on the 24th of May? 24th of May is 7-4s. 44th president, 2-4s. 4 years, 4 weeks, 4 months, 4 days, and 24th is 2-4s, 2-4s. That's 7-4s is coming up, 7-4s. So the death total was 24. This stuff is foreshadowing what's going on. There's a foreshadowing of what's going on. And how much do I want to get into this, what's going on? But destabilization, a whirlwind is destabilization. It's interesting, the wind around here today was blowing all the leaves in circles for some reason. All whirlwinds, all small whirlwinds all over the place. Whirlwinds symbolize going in circles. They symbolize chaos. whirlwind symbolized chaos. And as you see in Oklahoma, it's chaos. It is chaos. And right on the date that I pinpointed was this tremendously chaotic event, which is foreshadowing what is to come, When you have this conflictual idea, it plays out very, very nastily. And the more we try to impose peace on an idea of conflict, the stronger the conflict becomes, the greater the collapse, the greater the chaos, etc. So I've always seemed like a bad guy for saying, hey, don't try to bring peace to the world, that's the wrong way. But it turns out I'm right. Turns out I've been right all along. And the so-called spiritual elite have it wrong. They have it backwards. Absolutely have it backwards. You should never, ever try to impose love, peace, harmony, etc. on a conflictual idea. You're only going to make things worse. All your effort should be to choose a new idea, to repent, to say, mind, you are perfect. You've always presented exactly the idea I chose for you to present. Thank you very much. And now I'm going to choose a new idea. Let the Holy Spirit choose for you and choose a new idea and give that idea to mind, a non-conflictual idea. That is salvation. Everything else is damnation. It really is. So, yeah, I do have to speak up and go counter to the spiritual elites that have been supposedly teaching this idea of we need to all learn to harmonize together. That is not true. That is absolutely the worst thing you can do. Because what happens, again, is you get groups then that are in this harmony, and they think they've gotten rid of conflict, and yet they're still feeling it. So what do? They project it out of the group, out there, and then they see, oh, we're being persecuted, people don't like us, and they get this dynamic going. And what happens is they scapegoat groups. What happens, you get groups of people end up scapegoating those outside of the group, as those are the ones that are bringing the conflict, and they're disturbing our harmony. They say, we have this harmony, we have this love, we have no more conflict, and yet there are those out there that want to disturb it, and we need to get rid of them to protect our harmony. That's what happens. That's why you have the wars of religion, the factionalism in religion, fighting one religion. You know, they say, hey, we're fine, but those people out there, they're disturbing us. See, that is what brings problems. Any group, it doesn't have to be religious, any group of people, any person, the person too can say, hey, I'm in harmony, but you're disturbing my harmony. I'm in peace, but you're disturbing my peace. I have no conflict, but you are wanting to conflict with me, and so I have to get rid of that. I have to get rid of you. So that's what brings out all this intense wars and attack, etc., is groups getting together and projecting, agreeing that the enemy is out there, that they don't have any conflict, it's coming from out there. That's the problem. So we all have to take individual responsibility for the feeling of conflict, and saying the feeling of conflict is within us because it's the idea we chose. That's the idea. We all, are sinners. We all chose this idea of wanting to be prime creator, which is an idea that conflicts with reality. And so it's incumbent upon each one of us to repent and choose a new idea. It is not the way to get into some group or clique and claim that you have the harmony and that others outside don't. It becomes a very, very cult-like thing when that happens. Now, there's nothing wrong with people in a group who are practicing humility and repentance and choosing a new idea. That's fine to be supportive of that. That is fine. That's not a cult. I mean, that's a genuine religion. But situations in the world are such that people always say, hey, let's band together, and together we'll project the blame for conflict onto someone else, and then we are innocent and we don't have to repent, you see. Big, big, big mistake. Huge mistake. So I didn't know if I was going to say this today, because it flies in the face of conventional wisdom, conventional teaching. And I just realized this morning, it's wrong. The conventional teachings of this world are absolutely wrong. And that's why I got so scapegoated when I came into the world trying to tell the truth and people just said, man, you're terrible. How can you say such things? So the more people don't want to repent, the more they get together and the more they project and scapegoat others. See, the it's within the conflicted idea that they're holding. The idea of wanting to be prime creator, which means changing reality, is denying what reality is, and therefore is in conflict with truth, in conflict with reality. And that one must repent means change your mind. Choose it. Repent means choose a new idea. That's all that it means. Now, the term like Jesus or Christ, that stands for a non-conflicted idea. That's what it means, actually. A non-conflicted idea. So when Jesus says, there's only one way to the Father, is through me, meaning it's through a non-conflicted idea. That's the only way. You can never be at peace with a conflicted idea. It's impossible. You can't get the conflict out of a conflicted idea. It's impossible. So again, the only way to peace is a non-conflicted idea. So that's why you have to choose again. You must choose once again. That's the simple message. And it's not getting through to the world. It is not getting through to the world. Because what's happened in this world now is a bunch of projectionists have come into the world. And they say, hey folks, guess what? I got good news. Hey, you don't worry about it. Just join us and we will get rid of your guilt and conflict, inner conflict, etc. And because we will project it all out on scapegoats and then we'll attack those scapegoats. Put them in jail. Get rid of them. That's what's happened in the world. And people, of course, are suckers for that because repentance is hard work. Ironing out the objections is difficult work. And people don't want to do that difficult work. So they're suckers for those who say, hey, don't worry, we'll find the bad guys for you. And we'll get rid of them. Just join us and we'll get rid of them for you. So oftentimes the spiritual path of ironing out objections to salvation is a lonely path because you have to take individual responsibility for your own choice of wanting to be prime reader. Nobody's here by accident. Nobody's here because they are forced into it. They chose the idea of wanting to be prime creator. They said, hey, let's see what this is like. So that repentance has to come. They have to choose a new idea. There isn't any other path to salvation other than choosing a new idea, exchanging ideas. So I get irritated when I hear a spiritual teacher saying, well, let's everybody get together and let's build a peaceful world. Let's bring peace to this world, etc., etc. That is utter nonsense. It's the worst teaching possible. Instead, you'd say, let's everybody get together and support one another in our path of repentance and choosing a non-conflicted idea. Let's do that. You don't bring peace to conflict. All right, you bring conflict to peace and set it down. You don't bring peace to conflict. You bring conflict to peace and then make the exchange. You set the conflict down and choose the peace. And then you have complete, effortless bliss. You haven't changed the conflict. You've set it down. So what we do is we have all this conflict within us and we're trying to resolve the conflict. You don't resolve conflict. Conflict is not resolvable. It is not resolvable. So all the people in the world that are trying to resolve conflict, that is the wrong way. That's the Antichrist way. That doesn't work. You can't resolve conflict. That's the same thing as getting rid of the conflict in an idea of conflict. You can't do it. And the more you work on doing it, you think, well, we've invested all this time and energy, therefore let's just agree, you and I, that we've gotten rid of it. But we really haven't. So what do? We project it on someone else and scapegoat somebody else. That's exactly what happens. So we cannot get rid of the conflict. We cannot resolve the conflicts. Just let go of the conflict as it is. It's unresolvable. Okay, so this might be a declaration. The conflict within me is conflict that I'm feeling is unresolvable, so I choose to set it down as it is and choose a non-conflicted idea. The conflict within me is unresolvable. The conflict I'm experiencing is unresolvable. Conflict is unresolvable. Try that. Conflict is unresolvable. So I choose to set it down and choose a non-conflicted idea. So the key to salvation and a declaration, might say, conflict is unresolvable. And that's, again, a complete turnaround, isn't it? A complete turnaround. What is a whirlwind but an attempt to resolve a conflict? Is it not? It's like a dog chasing its tail, real faster and faster. The more we try to resolve conflict, the more intense the whirlwind becomes. Whereas if you just say, conflict is not resolvable. It's not so intense, is it? It takes the intensity out of it. See, conflict is not resolvable. Therefore, the way to peace is to choose a peaceful idea, to choose a non-conflictual idea, an idea that is not in denial and conflict with reality. There's no whirlwind there at all, is there? There's no conflict there. There's no need to try and get rid of the conflict that creates this whirlwind effect. So you might say that the past now, all the efforts to resolve conflict has created this incredible whirlwind in the world, an emotional, mental, conceptual belief whirlwind. And it's like the world is spinning and getting more and more going around in circles, faster and faster and faster and faster. And that eventually it shows up in various ways that we don't like. More intense ways that are very, very intense, and will continue to do so. And the 24th of May, you know, look out for that day. The whirlwind is getting stronger everywhere. And don't think that the fourth dimensionals play fair. They don't. They hit back harder than you can imagine. So this attempt to resolve conflict that's going on in the world may have some very unintended consequences, actually. We can jump into something now. We can jump into this if we can dare. False flags. Let's give an example of false flags. And let's listen to this all the way through, because there's some qualifications here. Let's say the president gets on television one of these days and says, world, I'm addressing the world. The scientists have now identified an asteroid that is coming right toward us, and it's going to hit us. Therefore, I am suspending the Constitution and imposing martial law so we can prepare for this asteroid hit, which is going to bring disaster. And so we're suspending all civil liberties, the Bill of Rights, confiscating all guns, et cetera, because of this asteroid that's going to hit. Okay. Now, that could either be true or it could be a false flag. You see, so a false flag, if it was not true that there is an asteroid that has been identified as coming in to hit the Earth, and yet they claim that there is one that they've identified to justify, you know, dictatorship, that would be called a false flag. That's a classic example of a false flag. However, it doesn't mean that there is no asteroid coming in. It could be not a false flag as well. So it's pretty tricky. I mean, it's difficult to talk about asteroids because it could be seen as a false flag. Most definitely. Same thing, but that's a classical one, really. So there could very well be an asteroid coming in. I would say there is. There are space rocks coming in that will impact Earth. Maybe as many as four of them. Two may be really bad, and two others not so bad. But there could be as many as four space rocks coming in how I see it. That doesn't preclude a false flag either, because even though they're coming in, the president could also say, make a false flag saying, hey, there's one coming sooner, or whatever, and then claim, you know, suspension of all civil liberties because of it. That could happen. That could really happen. It could happen. I think they're warming us up for that. So So when I say there's going to be unexpected surprises, the future is not what we think because of that. I mean, what's to stop the leaders of the world from saying this? What are people going to say? You know, if the scientists agree to go along with this, people will say, well, we have no way of verifying this, so we just have to take their word for it. Or on the other hand, you know, if it is true there are asteroids coming and space rocks, and we're told that it is, people will also rebel against it and say, well, you're just making that up as a false flag. It's not true, and they'll rebel against it. So it's a very slippery situation, actually, very much so. Now, what I would say is on the event that there are space rocks coming in, it's time to relocate, actually, off this planet. Whereas others might say it's time to suspend all our liberties and enslave everybody and put extreme controls on everybody in anticipation of global shortages and everything, etc. You know, everything has to be tightly regulated and monitored so that we can hopefully the most amount of people survive the troubles to come. So it's a different way of looking at it. And I'm in no position to do anything to anybody's liberty at all. So, you know, if it comes from the president, you know, they're in a position to do that. Whereas if it comes from a nobody, then they're not in a position to do anything. So it would be, you know, stupid for it to be a false flag. I don't believe it's a false flag at all. I do believe that there are space rocks incoming. I've always believed that. I've been shown that in many, many different ways, that that's what we're facing here. But don't be surprised if your civil liberties are suddenly taken away from you. Suddenly. Because of the announcement that they've seen that there are asteroids coming in. They've already said there's a near-Earth asteroid coming in the future at some point, which could be on a collision course. They've already, so they've seeded the ground with that, you see. So these are the times we call the tribulation times, where there will be cosmic catastrophes. And it's important at this time to look at the root of the whole situation, which is a conflictual idea, an idea that conflicts with reality, and to recognize that the only solution is to choose a new idea. If we keep the conflicted idea, we are going to experience conflict, period. We will experience fear and terror, the fear of annihilation. We will experience trauma, etc. All the nightmare, we will continue with that. And the more we try to make it better, the worse it gets. So this world is paradoxical. It's a trap in that the more we struggle to make it better, the worse it really gets. It's like quicksand. When you're in quicksand, don't struggle. Don't struggle. Stay very still. Control your breathing. Don't panic. And then know that help is there. But if you're all panicked and struggling, you don't even notice the help that's there. So when we get into this situation, we tend to say, oh my gosh, we need to make this place better. I want to be comfortable here. I want things to be nice. I don't want conflict. But, you know, that makes it worse. That makes it worse. Instead say, wow, this is a conflicted idea that I chose. Wow, I'm surrounded by conflict. Wow, I don't like that. What do I do? Oh, choose a new idea. Choose a new idea. See, that's the right response. That's the sane response. That's the basis of real teaching. But it's not easy for people to accept it. And therefore, so many people teach, oh no, I'm just here to bring peace to everybody. And everyone says, oh, thank you so much. You're going to bring peace to the world. Oh, great. Yeah, that's what I want, peace in the world. Everybody wants to feel peace, right? But they say, oh, I don't have to let go of this idea of conflict. I can keep it, and I can still be peaceful and happy. No, you cannot. No, you cannot. What people don't realize is they project the conflict and then end up aiding and abetting and participating and looking the other way with all sorts of atrocities, terrible things happening. And they say, well, it wasn't me. I'm very spiritual and peaceful. Yeah, you know. Yeah, no, it's part of the projection. that creates the whirlwind, that creates the problems, going around in circles. So this foreshadowing, there's been several foreshadowings. 9/11 was a big foreshadowing, of course. Foreshadowing of 4 asteroids coming in. 2 severe, hitting the Twin Towers. The planes coming and hitting the Twin Towers are signify asteroids coming and hitting the Earth. And then the one that hit the Pentagon, the one that went down a field, are 2 others that are not as significant. But 2 of them, you know, major. It's foreshadowing. And there's whirlwind, tornado also is a foreshadowing. And it's saying, hey, the going around in circles is getting more and more intense. So it's funny, the more people that pray for world peace, the less peace the world has. That may seem very surprising, but it's true. You don't want to pray for world peace, you want to pray for world repentance. Big, big difference. Huge difference. But there's nothing stopping us from doing that. The world should pray for world repentance. We should have World Repentance Day. We don't. We have all this Earth Day, Peace Day, blah, 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 and no Repentance Day. So in other words, people are just blind here, blind leaders of the blind in this planet. Now, what happens if we get everyone on the planet homogenized under a fourth dimensional dictatorship? And everybody says, oh, no, we have peace. We're all on the same page. We all agree. What happens? That's projected, the conflict's projected out to other, in the cosmos, to other planets. And then you get in conflict with other planets. Okay? So no matter what you do as far as forming a group agreement that you're in harmony, you will project out. The more bigger the group, the greater the projection. And so the greater the opponent, the enemy seems to be, so you end up getting into cosmic conflicts between this planet against this planet, this solar system against that, this section of the galaxy against this section. The conflict gets larger and larger and larger. So that's worse. It's better to say, hey, you know, I don't really like you, and you don't really like me, but you know what? Let's look at each other and smile and say, let's not make it any worse. Let's accept it. We don't get along so well. That's fine. Let's accept it. Let's go together to pray for repentance. Yeah. Interestingly enough, the institution that's most under attack in this world, the Catholic Church, when I go to the Catholic Church, the feeling I get there is pretty much like that. Is I don't feel any pressure to like anybody there. And nobody seems to have any pressure to like me, and nobody really tries to put on an act like I'm so spiritual or anything. Not at all. I've been going, I don't know how long now, but it's 3-4 years, or on and off for maybe 7. And I don't have a single friend in the entire congregation. I don't even know anybody. Don't even know anyone. But you say hello, peace to you, you know. But after that, people just go their ways, and you know, there's no pressure to act like putting on an act for someone, like you're trying to make them happy. You're basically there saying, like, my relationship with God is not right. And we're all there, we all have the same humility, saying, look, my relationship is not right. I need to get my relationship right, meaning I need to choose a non-conflictual idea. When people say I need Jesus, I mean they need a non-conflictual idea. You don't have to personalize it. The only thing I don't like is the personalizing. Say, I need this person, Jesus. No, you need a non-conflictual idea. That is what you need. But people tend to personalize things. So, you know, so what can you do? What can you do? And that's under severe, severe attack. Because they claim they're not with it. You know, they're not with the program, which is not to bring peace to the world. They're not with that. You know, they're not the fourth dimensional, let's get everybody smiling and let's be pleasing to one another. You know, that kind of thing, which is the road to ruination. But it shouldn't be pressure for each other to please each one another. There should not be any pressure on us like that. That is wrong pressure. the emphasis should not be on a personal level of pleasing one another, making each other happy. That's in placing impossible demands on one another. Our emphasis should be on repentance, period. It's a spiritual problem. It's not a personal problem. When we put this problem at the personal level, disaster. Disaster. It's a spiritual problem. It's a problem of causation. It's a problem of idea. It is not a personal human problem at all. So to try to solve it at a personal human level is ridiculous. Totally ridiculous. So we should not pressure one another to be pleasing to one another. And say, hey, how come they didn't smile at me? How come they didn't say, oh, hi, hug, I love you, all this kind of stuff. No, we shouldn't put that pressure on one another. It's ridiculous. Just it should be the equal acknowledgement that, hey, I need repentance, you need repentance. We're not pleasing to one another, and we don't need to be. Fine. And there's a mutual respect there. What happens in a world that's sane, that's based on repentance, is there's a mutual respect. Not a mutual like. Doesn't mean people get along. They don't hang out with each other. There's not some quota system, you know. There's divisions, and people tend to hang out with those they like, etc., etc. That's fine. But there's a mutual respect. It says, hey, I respect that you're focusing on repentance. You respect that I'm focusing on repentance. And there's a deep spiritual respect there. Personal, not so much. It doesn't matter. We realize, hey, the personal is superfluous. It doesn't matter. But the deep spiritual respect. So whatever you are, there's a spiritual respect. But that doesn't mean there's a personal liking. But so we've got it backwards in the world. Fourth dimensional stuff is getting completely backwards. They say it's all about the personal thing. And you'll have to love one another personally. And forget about the spiritual. That's all some fairy tale myth, blah, 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 whatever. Not true. They have it upside down and backwards. Or do you just need those cars and the tornado upside down? Everything's upside down and backwards. What we need is spiritual respect. Then you can say, well, I don't want to hang out with you. And you don't want to hang out with me, but we have a deep mutual respect and support for one another at a spiritual level. And I support your efforts toward repentance, and you support my efforts toward repentance. And we can come together, and if we need to be in a church or someplace, and work on ironing out our objections, and then go our separate ways, which is fine. It's not a problem. We're not trying to bring about a personal utopia here. We're not trying to bring a utopia on Earth. We're not human bodies. We're spirit. We're not flesh. We're spirit. We have a spiritual problem. We have a problem of choosing a conflictual idea. That's a choice by spirit, not by bodies, by flesh. Flesh is neutral. Didn't choose anything. Flesh doesn't choose ideas, spiritual ideas. Flesh has no choice whatsoever. It's neutral. It's just a sack of bones, you know, and flesh. It's nothing, doesn't choose, so it's not a personal thing. Don't take things personally. Just don't take things personally. I think the best advice I ever got was a friend of mine. I was in a lot of trouble, and he just said, hey, just don't care what other people think about you. Don't take it personally. And I said, how do you do that? He just said, you know, heck with them. Forget it. Not important. And that actually turned my life around. I said, wow, it's possible to don't take things so personally. Because I used to take everything so personally. Because I was trying to bring peace to the world. You know, not that I wanted to, but once I got pressured and scapegoated, then I felt like I needed to fit in to the world. I said, oh boy, how do I bring peace to the world? Which naturally started feeling very... take things personally from people, because you think, I'm trying to help you and be nice to you, and you're not responding to me. How are we going to have peace in the world if we don't get along? And let's resolve this. Let's work it out. Oh, man, it's just terrible. Just terrible. You get into all the psychology of, why don't you like me? Why don't I like you? All this personal nonsense. Just think how much better it is if we get together and say, I don't have to like you, and you don't have to like me, but we have a mutual respect for our focus on repentance, knowing that that is what we need. And so there's a deeper love than a personal love. Personal, in this world, at the personal level, there's bound to be conflict. Period. And the attempts to get rid of that is the worst thing possible. So But deep down, when you're on the path of repentance, deep down, there's a deeper love, a spiritual love, of supporting doing what works. And that's a different feeling than, it's not a personal thing. It's not a personal thing. So if I see somebody, there's a spiritual support there, but not necessarily a personal support. I may not like them, you know, they may not like me. I might say, you know, but I don't have to, you don't have to. So imagine how, what a relief that is to be told you don't have to like everybody and not everybody has to like you. And you don't have to worry about, don't take things personally. So I was on the freeway today and there was like a 50-50 type of thing on the freeway of blame, where I slow truck, I was behind the truck, someone else was behind me. We both decided to pull out almost at the same time. And of course, the car behind me was saying, hey, I don't want him to pull out in front of me, so I'm going to go fast and try to block him. But I said, hey, that's not right. I'm going to pull out anyway because I can see what they're doing. You know, so it was like 50-50 blame thing. I mean, they're the kind of drivers that don't like stopping for anything. And I said, hey, you know, sometimes you got to have respect to other drivers on the freeway and don't try to cut them, box them in like that. So, you know, so they drove past me and they put their arm out the window and yelling at me and stuff. And I just said, well, okay, they don't like that. And I don't like what they did. It's a 50-50 thing. Let it go. Don't worry. And they kept driving and weaving through traffic and putting their arm out the window. They're just, you know, they're just kind of rowdy drivers. And okay, so I said, well, you know what? That's okay. And you know, I'm sure in other situations we might be very simpatico, it's no problem. But in that particular situation, you know, it's kind of like it's a 50-50 blame game thing. And why take it personal? Don't take it personal. So most of the stuff in the world is very 50-50. You know, there's blame to go around, etc. Don't make anything personal. Don't make it personal. And yet people now are trying to personalize everything. That is the wrong path. That is entirely superficial, and it leads to worse and worse deep inner conflict and betrayal, feelings of severe betrayal. You know, you have all these intense relationships and people feel you betrayed me, you know. You were supposed to make me happy. We promised to make each other happy and you betrayed me, and it's just real severe stuff. You know, don't take it personal. Don't take it personal. Don't expect anything from anyone else on a personal level. Don't expect anything. And then you won't feel betrayed. I'm actually pro-arranged marriage. I think it's a very good idea. It works better. You do background checks on the family, on the relatives, on their astrological signs, on their this and this and that, and you get together a whole research into the people and to see if there's a sort of a compatibility there, and can the families get along, you see. That's very important, because where's the support of the in-laws? So it's this whole thing of romantic love of, you're going to make me happy, I'm going to make you happy, let's solve our conflict by, you know, romantic love, is ridiculous. It leads to divorce, it leads to breakdown of society, etc., because you're expecting too much of the other person. Way too much. Way, and you're going to feel betrayed. And I'm also not really, I'm not for divorce either, really, because the fact is, grass is always greener on the other side. And you get a romantic marriage, it doesn't work, it breaks down, you feel betrayed, you say, this over there is much better. And because then, depending on personal happiness, someone's supposed to give me some happiness, someone's supposed to remove the conflict from my life. It's impossible. You're placing impossible demands on one another. So arranged marriage, you're not expecting much. You say, well, let's just see if we can manage, you know, our affairs of life, business and the household and work with kids, etc. Let's just see if we can manage this together effectively. But we're not expecting happiness from one another. That's ridiculous. Can't get happiness from this world, from idea of conflict. Impossible. And so when tough times come and etc., you say, well, it's expected. You know, conflict comes. And you don't get divorced and you say, well, let me find someone who where there's no conflict. It breaks down society. Breaks down society. So traditional values are actually wiser and more effective, and they're not just being thrown away, and they're being attacked and they're gone. They're based on wisdom. They're based on wisdom. This idea of the grass is always greener, you can go down that path forever. And you'll still be in this, just feel betrayed constantly. You feel the whole world's betraying you, actually. Because you're failing. You're not making people happy. They're not making you happy. And you think, what's wrong? What? Somebody's wrong. Somebody's terrible. It ends up in suicide. People say, well, I failed others. You know, who puts the burden of making others happy? You know, that's an impossible burden on yourself. That you're supposed to make other people happy. It's impossible. You cannot get rid of the conflict within the idea of conflict. Nobody can. Nobody can. Did the great gurus bring happiness to the world? No. Conflict is still there. Absolutely. They gave them a taste of how the non-conflicted idea feels, so people can say, hey, maybe I should choose a non-conflicted idea. That's a good idea to do, right? But they don't bring happiness to the world. They don't make the world happy. It's ludicrous to think that way. And that's the way we think, unfortunately, because we're still ignorant. But ignorance is no excuse. Ignorance doesn't get rid of the conflict either. Now, people think that if they just ignore the conflict, it'll go away. They say, keep ignoring it, and eventually it'll go away. It doesn't go away. Never. Only by choosing a new idea. So we're all kind of waiting, saying, is the conflict gone yet? Is the conflict gone yet? We've had a romantic life and trying to please others and trying to get a good life, and hopefully the conflict is gone by now. Is it gone? And we're all assuming it maybe must be gone now. It's not gone. That tornado wasn't made up, you know. It happened. And conflict happens. It's not gone. It's not gone at all. And yet there's so many in the world expected to be gone. And they place these great expectations on their leaders and their teachers and all this stuff, like, you're supposed to get rid of the conflict for me. And of course, all those who promise to do so, of course they can be elected to the highest office of the land. All you have to do is be a really good promiser and project to people and tell them that you can get rid of the conflict. I can get rid of it, I can get it. And people will vote for you. They'll put you in the highest office if you convince them that you'll be able to get rid of conflict for them. The problem is you can't. And eventually they start finding that out. And when they start finding out, that's when the leaders, some start cracking heads. You know, they realize, uh-oh, here comes the whirlwind for me. And some of them start getting really proactive at that time, because they realize, oh my gosh, I sold everyone a bill of goods that I could get rid of conflict. I knew it's impossible, but I did. I knew I could get elected, so why not exploit that loophole? But now it's coming back to bite, and they say, oh, I better bite first. Look out. Because those who exploit that and get to high office, they know, they already usually prepare for that eventuality, is that the natives will start getting restless, and people start saying, hey, you didn't get rid of the conflict for us. In fact, it's worse than ever. So they already know that's going to happen. The smart ones, the shrewd ones, the real shrewd ones already know that's going to happen. And they've already planned contingency plans for that. And those contingency plans can be quite a surprise. And not at all pleasant, actually. So, again, don't expect the conflict in the world to be gone. Don't think that somehow we've banished conflict. We have not. It's worse than ever right now. It is worse than ever. Just compared to the past, it's worse now. It's really worse. It's deeper. It's more vicious. It's at a more intense level now. Sure, there's always been conflict in this world. There always has been. And very intense on a physical level. But right now, it's gotten deeper. It's gotten deeper. It's gotten more personal. Before, it was like conflict, like, well, our rulers say we got to go fight you, and so we're going to go to war, and we're in the battle. We're going to try to win. But then after that, the battle's over. Forget it. Go home. Nowadays, it's become so vitriolic at a personal level, of personal hatred, of personal demonization, polarization of projection of you are the enemy, you are the bad guys, you're wicked, you're the conflict, the conflict's in you, and we need to pull the plug on you. And it's, so it's become way, way, way more intense than in the past. I mean, in World War II, for example, that my parents' generation, the ones who fought World War II, during the war, they, of course, they fought as valiantly as possible. And once the war was over, it's like, okay, here's an example. My dad, just to point out how things are different now from back then. He flew into Tokyo after to sign the MacArthur Honor Guard, flew in, landed in Tokyo. They decided they were going to sign the peace treaty on the USS Missouri, something like that. And so he was in the airstrip in Tokyo with the other pilots that flew in the Honor Guard. And he decided, you know, he didn't like sitting around. He liked to move, maybe a attention deficit disorder or something. Had to be very active. And decided to get in a Jeep and start driving off the airport, which we weren't supposed to. And of course, I guess it was, you know, court martial. It was an offense. It was disobeying orders. But he said, I want to go out and drive around and see the Tokyo. So him and a friend, they took a Jeep and drove off base and drove through Tokyo and went out in the countryside and ended up driving all over Japan. And instead of hatred, the people said, welcome. We have no hatred for you. Welcome. You know, we fought a war. We lost. Okay, it's over. And my dad and you know, the people there, they said, wow, it's over for us too. It's over. Okay, so for a lot of people that came back from World War II, yes, they had terrible stories, etc. But for many of them, you know, it wasn't personal. It's over. It wasn't personal. It was a terrible thing, but it's over. And my dad ended up loving Japan, you know, and going there. And I've been there, and it wasn't personal. Nowadays, can you imagine how different it is now where the flame wars on the internet? Things become more and more and more and more personal, which is much worse. It is much worse where people have literal hatred of one another at a deep personal level of the content of their character, of their mind, and everything. So it's not just a matter of you're just mercenaries fighting this war between two empires, and when the war's over, hey, the soldiers get together and say, hey, it's all over. We lay down our arms, let's embrace and say, peace between us, no more war between us, and let us learn from one another and move on. No, it's different now. It's different. It's become personal. So again, it's worse now. It's way, way worse. It's not personal just because the leaders say that country's bad. You know, no. It's because the people have made it personal. Because of the whole ideology that we're supposed to bring happiness and peace to this planet, and the teaching that is our mission and goal, that we end up then personalizing everything too much and being super disappointed and demonizing the opposition, those who seem to be in conflict with us, who are not going along with our idea of what's peaceful. You know, you get in conflict. I mean, Google says do no evil, fine. But who's defining evil? Who's the one that is defining what evil is? Sorry, anyone can say, do no evil. But who's doing the defining of what evil is? You know what I mean? So everyone has a different definition. So everybody has a definite, you know, what is righteous, what they think it will get rid of conflict. And nothing works. Nothing works. Nothing works. It's just you end up scapegoating one another. And once it gets super personal, the scapegoating is just very, very bad. So we're at a new phase in history. We're at a new phase in history here. And we need new ideas. We need better ideas to deal with the situation. That's what I'm trying to do here, is get better ideas. The idea of choosing a new idea is the best idea is it's salvation itself. It's the only way. and we need this idea to circulate. You know, I'm doing what I can do, but the problem is that people, again, have personalized everything too much, way too much. And I always felt this was so wrong, and it's turned out to be that way. Even if it puts me at odds with some other teachers, etc., so be it. You know, this is how I see it now. I don't have to like them, they don't have to like me. Or I'm just, it's not about psychology, it's not about personal self. It's not about personalizing. I don't have to get along with you, you don't have to get along with me, none of that stuff. It's about repentance, choosing a new idea. That's what it's all about. It'll always be that. And we are headed towards, right now what's happening in the world is the fourth dimension is subjugating the third dimension on this planet. And what they've done is give the third dimension those bread and circuses. Okay, just like the Romans, bread and circuses. Give them all this entertainment, so the third dimension will just say, oh, this is kind of, I got all this entertainment, that's cool. I don't really worry about anything else as long as I got my bread and my circuses, my food and, you know, drugs and entertainment. What do I care? What do I care about what anyone does? As long as I got my food, my entertainment, I don't care. And meanwhile, they're being subjugated, turned into slaves by the fourth dimensionals. And a civilization that is based on everybody has to like everybody else or else they're a criminal, you know, that kind of thing. So it ends up then turning this planet into a planet that gets in conflict with other planets. Ultimately, with fourth dimensionality, what happens there is planets fight other planets. There's planetary conflict. We call it the war in the heavens. In the Bible, there's been war in the heavens going on. That's fourth dimension. The fourth dimension, you have planetary wars. And that's why the fourth dimensionals wanted to take over Earth. This is a very important base for them, strategically, in their wars, cosmic wars. It's very important for them to have a base, planet Earth be their base here. That's why they want it. So you end up projecting conflict on planets and solar systems again, and getting into these mega conflicts. It's terrible. And of course, this has been known for forever, you know, and so it's no surprise that someone can come to this planet and say, hey, folks, we need to set up a religion, we need to set up some discipline here on this planet so we don't get caught up in the fourth dimensional situation, don't have them take over the planet, because it makes things worse. So of course, it's no problem. People, anyone who has an overview of this can incarnate on this planet and tell people that this is what's going on, this is what you need to do, you need to repent. It's not surprising at all that people have awareness of these cosmic battles in the fourth dimension and come here and say, this is what's going on. What's the big deal about that? And people make a big deal like, oh, isn't it amazing? It's not amazing at all. It's just standard practice. It's just stating the obvious. So we should not be so in awe of our religions, in awe of that at all. Not awe. It's just what works, common sense. It's how to avoid severe suffering, how to avoid making things worse, how to get free, how to be saved. So you might say we can all be at a very high level now because we see what's going on, we see what's happening, and now we can say, wow. Yeah, it's no big deal that somebody thousands of years ago could tell us about this, because they're simply reporting what's have been going on for eons, as it were. And, you know, we can report it now. We say, oh yeah, we can say the same thing. We can say the same thing. We can have the same wisdom and say the same thing now. What is difficult is to go into a situation where people are unaware of that and try to help them out. That is difficult because they don't know what you're talking about, and they'll hold you in awe, which you don't want to be held in awe. And how to cope with that is not easy. But these days, you know, so many people can say, I see what's happening. We understand Star Wars. We understand there's conflict and wars in space. And, you know, our minds are much more open and realizing, hey, yeah, you know, hyperdimensional travel, wormholes, all these ways of going through time and space and et cetera, of, you know, all this stuff, fourth dimensional stuff is, yeah, of course, that's taking place. That's fourth dimensional stuff. Of course they're here. Of course they're taking over the planet. It's obvious. So we need to get back to repentance. And not all this personal junk, you know, this personal stuff is ridiculous. Building relationships. How do you get rid of the conflict? Projecting it. There's no other way. You cannot have your cake and eat it too. You cannot have a conflicted idea of conflict and get rid of the conflict. You're bound to project it somewhere. Absolutely bound to project it. Sweep it under the carpet. Which eventually in a relationship is based on that. You've got so much stuff under the carpet, you know, it just falls apart. But in a relationship that's not based on you make me happy, I'll make you happy, and we can get rid of conflict by just saying, hey, let's support each other in our efforts toward repentance. That's a stable relationship. Fairly stable relationship. It's not without its troubles, but that one is a stable one, and it's a good one. It's an effective one. It's a helpful one. You don't even have to like each other that much, you know. I don't really like them that much, but hey, they help me, I help them towards repentance. That's helpful. That is helpful. So hopefully this talk has been helpful. Definitely giving you something to think about. Is that not everything you've been told maybe, you know, helpful, actually. You have to say, well, wait a minute, what's really helpful, you know? Should I really be looking for love in all the wrong places, you know? It should give you pause enough to say, now, wait a minute, okay. Maybe I don't need to be stampeded by the fourth dimensionals. Maybe I don't have to romanticize life. Maybe I don't have to do it. Maybe I can repent. Maybe I can actually choose a new idea. Why not? Maybe that's really possible. Maybe I can iron out my objections. Maybe if I work out, I probably can. And then you become less susceptible to wasting your time. And get on with it. And be a fifth dimensional. Where the wise dwell, the wise dwell. For those who are focused on choosing a new idea, that's where they dwell. Now, it's not necessary that you have chosen a new idea in order to be a fifth dimensional. It's only necessary that that's where your intention is, where you've decided that's where you're going to place your efforts. You're not going to expect others to make you happy. You're going to choose a happy idea. A non-conflicted idea, and then nothing can make you unhappy at that point. Nothing can make you unhappy. So, we have now, what's today, 21st? 3 more days is the 24th. I don't know what's going to happen, but the alignments are not good. Every time I look at the doggone clock, it seems like I'm seeing 444. I'm seeing 444 everywhere. It's like, whoa, wow, I get in the truck, the odometer reads 444. It's like, wow, what is going on? It's all about 4444 now. It's all about fours. It's all about the fourth dimension starting their beat down now. And stay tuned. We'll see what happens. In the meantime, see if you can digest this. And don't have to agree with it. Don't have to like me, think, oh, do I like what's being said or like him or anything? Not forget that. Just see if you can digest it and say, feel some wisdom in it. And take the pressure off yourself. You're supposed to like people. They're supposed to like you. No. You can be civil. So you can like people if you want to. You can be civil and kind and patient and all that stuff. But don't take anything personal. Keep working on that. Don't take anything personal. And things will go much better for you, for sure. All right. That's it for this one.